everybody. My name is Dr. James Deom, and I am very honored to be the U.S. Northeast representative and educational consultant for Valley Contacts. I'm also in private practice. I'm a partner of a two-office location, Hazleton Eye Specialist, Stroudsburg Eye Specialist, and we have two subclinics, the Dry Eye Center of Northeastern Pennsylvania and the Scleral Lens Institute. I'm here today with you to talk to you about billing and coding, a topic that baffles many individuals and often is the reason why people do not get into scleral lenses, especially in private practice, because we know that when we bring something on into our practices, we have to be able to be profitable to be able to provide that to our patients. It's something that can't sink our ship. We need it to help our ship flourish. So billing and coding, it's a necessary evil. And I think when I talk to people about billing and coding, I kind of have two categories of people. One, individuals that have been in practice and they've gotten somewhat jaded by the whole idea and they've kind of given up on it. And a whole other group of individuals that don't really know anything about it yet and aren't yet jaded, but are excited to learn and know from talking to others that if they do it correctly, it could be a very, very good part of their knowledge base in their practice, especially in private practice. Now, when it comes to the patients that we're going to be talking about billing, we really have another two groups. And these two groups of individuals are gonna be patients that fit into a category of medically necessary billing and coding. And then we're gonna have another group of individuals that are going to be similar to the patients that I talked about from an internal referral basis that maybe don't fit into a medically necessary category. Don't be afraid to have a separate fitting fee or fee schedule for normal eyes. These individuals are not going to maybe take as much time to fit. It's going to be a different approach. So it's perfectly fine to have two fitting fees, one for normal eyes and one for medically necessary eyes. That's a question I get all the time. And I think to be very busy and interested and involved and invested in custom stable lenses, it's good to have these two sources, normal eyes and also medically necessary eyes. So I think the regular eye billing and coding really is up to you. So I'm not gonna go into that in too much detail, but I am going to talk about medically necessary billing and coding now. And I think there's three avenues by which you're going to be doing medically necessary billing. You're gonna have patients that come in and have no insurance. That's number one. Number two, you're going to have patients that come in and have a vision plan only, no medical plan. Then you're also going to have a group of people that may only have a medical plan, no vision plan. And then you're gonna have a whole other group of people that are gonna have both. And each one of these is going to be approached in a different way. The no insurance group is really easy. You're gonna bill them according to your fee schedule. You don't have to worry about writing a letter of medical necessity. You don't have to worry about telling the patient, you know, we're gonna have to wait and see what your insurance does, if they're gonna cover all or some. You're gonna be very upfront and forward with the patient on what the cost of the fitting is, what that includes, and what they should expect. And I think what's really important in this category, the no insurance category, is be careful that you don't quote the patient a global price on fitting and then have the patient be coming back time and time and time again. Be definitive in what the fitting includes. Don't spend follow-up after follow-up after follow-up seeing this patient when you're just evaluating the lens. That fitting period has to end at some point. In our practice, it's after the patient starts to be able to wear that lens and put it in, take it out regularly without further teaching moments. So when that patient has adapted to the lens, that fitting period is over. Now we're into evaluating that lens. And I'll often give the analogy of glaucoma, very similar to glaucoma. With glaucoma, we see patients back for follow-up, we check their pressure. So we're evaluating the condition, glaucoma in the presence of the treatment, which is the drop. In specialty lenses and medically necessary lenses, we're evaluating a medical condition. So let's say keratoconus, the treatment is the lens. We're gonna see them back, we're gonna evaluate the condition, which is keratoconus, and the treatment of the lens. Just because the patient doesn't have insurance doesn't mean that we should, you know, give our services away for free after we have fit the patient and we're following up their condition, just like you would do if it was a glaucoma patient. The next category is a vision plan only. And vision plan only category patients are actually a pretty good group of patients. And I say that because usually your vision plans have a really nice, well-defined pathway for getting coverage for medically necessary lenses. Each plan has a defined list of conditions that define medical necessity, and they're not all the same. And I won't go into all of them, but many of them are keratoconus, irregular astigmatism, anisometropia of a certain degree, refractive error of greater than 10 diopters in either direction. So become familiar with the categories of medically necessary coverage that are specific to the vision plans that you take. Also know that the vision plans usually have a method for which you apply for medical necessity. Many of them have a form. The ones that don't have a form, you often have an online form that you'll fill out that you simply just click go at the end and it goes off to whoever checks it and they send it back whether it's covered or not. If you have questions about a specific plan that you take, feel free to get in touch with me at any time. I'd be happy to let you know the way in which you get medical necessity for vision plans. Generally speaking, there's a covered list, and then there's a form you're gonna fill out, you're gonna send to the company, and they're gonna tell you whether it's approved or not approved. Just because a patient has insurance X, and another patient comes in with also insurance X, and the first patient I mentioned, has medically necessary coverage. We can't assume that the other patient who has the same insurance will also have medically necessary coverage. So it's important that every time you have a patient come in, whether they have the same insurance or a different insurance, that you go through the process and find out before you communicate to the patient, yes, you have coverage or no, you don't. Never want to promise anything to a patient before you've known, because this is very important. You want to set the expectations appropriately. There are many sub-plans within carriers. And so even if a patient works at the same location and gets their insurance from the same employer, they may have a different plan within that employer. So it's important you always go through the process, never promise anything to a patient, make sure you get confirmation of payment before you ever dispense a lens to a patient. Medical plans. Now, medical plans are a little bit more difficult. They usually do not have a defined pathway for coverage like the vision plans do, and will often require what we call a prior authorization. So a staff member of yours is going to have to call the medical plan, let them know what's going on, and ask to see if this patient has coverage for medically necessary contact lens benefit. The insurance company should at that time tell you whether or not this patient has coverage or doesn't have coverage. Sometimes you need to call different people within the same company. You have to be an advocate for these patients. And sometimes you will be told no, sometimes you'll be told yes. And in those situations, when we are told yes, this is pretty good. You know, we go back and tell the patient, hey, we got coverage, we're good. And in the times when it's no, it's a little bit of a defeat. But I want to tell you, with the medical plans, you have another opportunity. And that opportunity is to ask the patient to advocate for themselves. Medical plans, a little bit different than vision plans, will flex a little bit in some scenarios when the patient advocates for themselves. So we always tell the patient, give a call, tell them the situation, and we will actually go as far as to provide them a letter that outlines the reason why they need these lenses and some personal reasons why these lenses are going to benefit their life, maybe their work, maybe their ability to get from point A to point B. And in those cases, there are scenarios where medical plans who've told us no will then say yes. So it's very important to get the patient involved, especially when it comes to medical plans and coverages for medically necessary lenses. The last group is medical and vision plan. And these are the bulk of the patients that I see, so I'm most familiar with this group. Usually in this case, the vision plan is going to come before the medical plan in whom you should bill first. So if a patient has vision plan A and medical plan B, you're going to bill the vision plan A first. So you're gonna go through the defined process that I mentioned earlier about filling out the form, sending it in, waiting for the approval. And then, what's very important in this particular case, similar to what I said about the no insurance group, is you want to make sure that you've defined what is that fitting period. Because at a certain point, just because we build the vision plan for the fit and the lenses and gotten paid, we're going to end that period and we're going to still need to follow these patients. So make sure you know that the patient is aware that when they do follow up, that you're evaluating them for a medical condition, which requires medical care and follow up, they may have a copay, they may have co-insurance. They need to be aware of these things. A lot of times patients think, well, I got it covered, it's all good, I'm coming back, I'm here for that same thing, why am I having to pay a copay? So if you say something that a patient is going to encounter down the line ahead of time, it's not perceived as a mess up. It's not perceived as a oversight. It's something that they were aware of. You set the expectations appropriately. But if a patient has to be surprised by a copay or a coinsurance 2 months into an experience that was otherwise really pretty good, you might be surprised how that patient reacts and changes their mind on how wonderful that experience was. So set the stage appropriately, make sure they know what they're in for. The next thing I want to talk to you about when it comes to billing and coding for medically necessary lenses is your charts and your charting. It's very important. You'll hear individuals going through an audit, and the things that are reviewed and talked about during this process. And you should be comfortable knowing that your charts could undergo an audit at any time. Things you want to be aware of and really diligent about is your documentation in reference to the ordering of the medically necessary lens. We need to know why a patient is going to do better with a custom stable lens versus, say, regular contacts, soft lenses, and glasses. Indicate an improvement in their best corrective visual acuity that is significant, and indicate comfort levels. So that's first thing. Second thing is, include diagnostic and testing that you've done that backs up the diagnosis that you're treating them for, and also the fact that this lens is doing well on their eye and that they're seeing better. Things like topography and anterior seg OCT will add to the overall robustness of your charting, and make sure that you're appropriately documenting for those tests as well, providing order and interpretation at the same time. Lastly, when it comes to scleral lenses, you're going to want to make sure that you indicate in your chart that you've properly taught the patient how to use the lens and care for the lens. This is a very important component of providing somebody a medical device, is that you want them to be successful with the device and that they're safely doing that. And that's one of the things that insurance companies are looking for, that you've gone through that process and you've documented it appropriately in your chart. Those are the things you're going to want to make sure you do to make sure that you can withstand an audit. I've often heard it's not what you make on a scleral lens that is important, it's what you get to keep after you get audited. The next thing I want to talk to you about is office flow. And really this has to do with how you're going to receive payment and dispense the lenses. And the overarching theme I want you to keep in your mind is, don't let a lens leave your office without receiving payment. That's the bottom line. Several times in the beginning of practice, I, having a heart this big, left patients leave the office saying to myself, I trust them, I believe them, there's no way that I would get burnt by this person. And every single time I've done it, I've gotten burnt. So know that, you know, once that patient leaves your office, there's no reason for them to have to come back. And that's a big ethical issue and clinical responsibility issue, because if a patient leaves your office and they don't get payment from the insurance company and they decide never to pay you, then they're out there wearing that lens and you're the one who fit them with it. And if a complication occurs, it might be your butt on the line for it. So make sure, no matter how it works, that you get payment prior to letting that patient leave the office with the lenses on. So the next thing I want to talk to you about are a couple codes. And there are many different codes. I'm sure you've seen some of them or heard some of them, maybe used some of them. But you know, there's going to be a couple that are very important. The first one is going to be your keratoconus fit code, okay? And that is going to be 92072. And the 92072 is going to be important because that's the fitting code for keratoconic eyes. And that's going to be a big one for your custom stables. One important thing to know about this is that this code is a bilateral code, so you only need to do it once for both eyes. And another kind of debate out there is whether or not this should be rebilled on follow-up visits. And my opinion is the answer is yes. If patient is keratoconic and they need to be fit, we use the keratoconic fit code. And then if they need to be fit on subsequent visits, because it is still a keratocone, we still use that. So those are my take-home points for the 92072. Bilateral and can be used on second or follow-up visits. The second code I want you to know about is the scleral lens fit code. And this will be used in situations where the patient is not a keratocone, so everything else. That's gonna be 92313. And so this is gonna be a very important code because it's going to satisfy every other fit that of a custom stable lens for eyes that are not keratoconic. This is different than the 92072 in that it is a unilateral code. So you'll bill that for the right eye and the left eye. Lastly, as far as codes are concerned, I'm gonna hit on two V codes. And V codes are our material codes. So we have the procedural code, the 92072 and the 9313. The V code, purpose of this is to tell the insurance company what it is that we're providing the patient, what it is that they're paying for. So we have two V codes that I want to hit on. One is the scleral lens V code, and that's V2531. V2531. So this satisfies all the scleral lenses you're going to be using for any condition you could possibly be fitting a scleral lens for, and that'll satisfy those requirements. The second V code that I want to talk to you about is a little more controversial, and many people don't even know about it or use it. And that's the scleral shell code, V2627. And I have to say that I use this code quite often, and the reason I use this code is for dry eye. And if you really get down into the nitty-gritty of the definition of this code, you'll see there's a large paragraph in the beginning that talks about using this in eyes that are thysical or eyes that can be covered and in individuals who are really have no vision or have lost vision, that this can protect the ocular surface. And while that is true, there's, if you continue reading, an area that talks about a tear reservoir and using this in cases of dry eye that are recalcitrant to current treatment. I have tons of patients that fit that category, and I'm sure you do as well. So when you have a patient that would benefit from a scleral lens or a custom stable, more specifically, think about the V2627 code. That's going to be a code that is going to be the scleral shell code. This is often a code that's reimbursed at a higher rate. So it's something that I think you should add into your repertoire. Again, just make sure you're documenting in your chart things that the patient has failed on, in particular relationship to dry eye, and the reason why you're going to the scleral lens for medical necessity for treatment of the condition, which is, in this case, dry eye. So that pretty much concludes our conversation about billing and coding. I want to leave you with a thought. The thought is that it's an ethical obligation of ours to provide life-saving, life-changing vision to patients when we're capable of doing that with our custom stable lenses. So if a patient comes in and you're unsure about whether or not you want to provide them custom stable lenses because you're not sure how to bill and code it appropriately, really that's an ethical dilemma because you're able to give them sight restoring vision by giving them this lens and you're unable or uncomfortable to do so because of the finances associated with it. Don't fall into this trap. You can do it. I want to leave you today and ask you to all get out there and save some eyes with some custom stables and have a good time doing it.